I'm Nakul. I'm going to talk about making magic. And before I actually start on that, I want to tell you about how I came across magic. As a young kid, I was fascinated by everything that was magical. I believed that there was real magic. And I believed that the world was... I believed that the world had magic. I believed in people like sorcerers who could do things. As a five-year-old, I saw somebody come on stage and do exactly that. I saw this person come on stage and show that he had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 cards. And from those 6 cards, this magician took 1, 2, 3 cards, threw them away. I was seated like you, sir, looking like that. And then he did that, he still had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 cards. I don't know about you, but I clapped. Now, it took me a while, it took me a long time to realize that the person I had seen was not a sorcerer. He is what is known as a magician. A magician doesn't have powers. A magician comes on stage, shows his hands are empty, shows he has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 cards, and a magician can at any point in time take 1, 2, 3 cards, throw them away, and still show he has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 cards. Thank you. Now, I don't know that magic, so I can't show it to you. But somewhere in life, I did magic. I got on stage and I did different kinds of magic. I was fascinated by this character called Mandrake the Magician. Mandrake fans?
Yes, yes.
My generation right there. So Mandrake could get on a stage, gesture hypnotically, and make you see whatever it was that he wanted you to see. He could, if a terrorist came at him with those rifles, he could just say, why are you holding the banana? Oh, it's a banana. The world was so much simpler then. And this is why we have magic. We have Enid Blyton, we have Mom, we have Trudy Cannon, and everybody talking about their version of magic. And when we look at this magic, we definitely... But magic goes back years. Magic, this is a book. It talks about magic from the 1400s to the 1950s. 1400s, ladies and gentlemen. And if you thought 1400s was old enough, it is indeed 1400, because this painting was done around 1475 to 1480. It's a French painting, and you have a magician performing the oldest known effect in the world called the cups and balls. If you also see, there is that small person, the kid, and behind him, there is a person picking somebody's pocket. Yeah, magic is so powerful that you're caught into it that you don't notice anything else that's happening around it. But that's not true. 1584 was also the year when Discovery of Witchcraft was written. It's the first known book on magic. 1584. And this book basically tells there is no such thing as magic. How sad is that? It basically tells you how you can have a decapitated head on a chair, and you know, it basically exposes it. And there was another book written around the same, a couple of hundred years later. What a couple of hundred years in India, right? 1798, there was this German book which essentially did this. Why? Because magic was so powerful that anybody who did magic on stage was looked on as a witch, a wizard, a warlock, and typically chopped their heads off. And, but we are talking 1400s? No. 2500 BC, you had in the Beni Hassan tomb an imagery that has been debated highly about being the first reference of the cups and balls. There are others that say they're just bakers making bread. But it doesn't just stop there, because around the same time, there is a book, or not really a book, the oldest known parchment called the Westcott Papyrus, 18th to 16th century BC, that's 5,000 years back, which describes a performance by a sorcerer called Devi, magician Devi. He took a goose and he was performing in front of Cheops, the pharaoh who built the pyramids. Chopped the head off of the goose and then put it back together and the goose walked off. He was known, and he is imprint and in history known as the first magician ever. And that actually is 5,000 years. And of course, India, we can't really date it back. We can talk about the Mahabharata, the Ramayana, and talk of those as references to magic. But we have our own contributions, like the mango tree. Kerala has even now itinerant performers who do the Indian mango tree. Over a period of half an hour, you would see the entire story from how a seed becomes a mango, right? And they would actually hand out the mango for you to eat, even in non-seasons. I don't know how they get it in non-seasons. And of course, the elusive Indian rope trick. Sadly, the only old image that we have is of the great Karachi, who the world believes was born in India, but actually is an Australian, and used to perform his version. This is late, mid-1934 actually, this image of the Indian rope trick. Why am I showing all this? At one point in time, magic was indistinguishable from science. Kausto was sitting right at the back because I told him I'm going to ask him some questions and answer my questions here. But Arthur C. Clarke said that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. Remember the words sufficiently advanced. We have computers now that can beat people in chess. I think early 2000s, right? Deep Blue. This is from 1770, a mannequin that played chess with Napoleon and beat him at it. Napoleon tried to cheat, the mannequin just threw the whole board off. Of course, it was a trick. You have the enchanted orange tree. That, by the way, is Jean-Eugène Rabatoudan, who is known as the father of modern magic. He was a clock worker. He made incredible illusions. This was his version of the Indian mango tree. If only he knew the real one, it's so much simpler. And this, of course, my religion or my God stronger than your God, the classic light and heavy chest. The performer, again, Rabatoudan, takes a simple chest, brings it up, keeps it down, and then the itinerant people can try all they want. They can't lift it. Technology sufficiently advanced. Electromagnets were just coming up. Most world did not know about it. Anytime a magician, and we even do that till very recently, because trust me, magicians have used technologies that, you know, far before others have. Be it Bluetooth, be it Wi-Fi, we always look at how can I put it in a show? And how can I read your mind? Just write it with this pencil. The Illusionist is a brilliant movie which actually takes some of these real life incidences of magic and puts it on stage, and you see the electromagnet at work there because he has the sword. How many of you have seen the movie? Okay, about six of you. So if he puts the sword on stage and he walks off, the prince comes and he can't take the sword off. Electromagnet at work. David Copperfield and his flying. Now understand this, magic is all about science. It's all about taking science as you know it and presenting it back to you in a way that you or even the scientist that came up with the idea will not be able to figure out. Because like Uri Geller is one of the most venerated or hated magicians of our times. He bends spoons. This Stanford University created a study on him, ran a study on him, and called something the Geller effect. This is the mind over matter, he can bend spoons. Okay, but the point is that those scientists were looking for that answer. They wanted to believe in it. And so here's Copperfield, breaking all known forms forms of science at that time. Thank you. This is more recent, dynamo, walking on water. You've all seen this on TV more recently. Thank you. And David Blaine cheating death, catching a bullet. And he took bullet catching, which has been an effect 13 magicians have died on stage over the years. He took it to a level where he really almost died. Because being Blaine, he just wants to take it to areas which nobody ever wants, you know, to work on later. But the point where we are today, as Kaustubh so brilliantly articulated, and scarily for me as a magician, is technology is changing, science is changing. Harkaway's thought comes to mind. He says it's not that any sufficiently advanced technology is magic. It's that any technology taking place beyond the threshold of our senses is. Imagine, there were times when somebody sat down and wrote a book. Most science fiction that's been written and dreamt about are true already. Those things in the movies are out there. We have, recently I saw a video of a new inventor who could just stand like this and have a drone land on his hand. And then he could do this and do that, and the drone would just follow gesture. And the chimera van. Now this is bringing magic into our daily life. You have a wand with which it's a universal remote. You can control anything you want. You can say, okay, next slide. See, it worked. without even a wand. Kinetics and things like that, right? You just need to stand in front of your TV, imagine you're holding something, and the TV will see you holding it. And this is not too far, and there are houses who have installed specific technology to make this happen already. But I think in this next year, we will all have TVs which would not need remotes. Gesture will change it for us. But the point is this, right now, in this room, all of us are wearing enchanted objects. Enchanted objects, as is called in my other world, called the user experience. We call them enchanted objects because what you're actually doing is you're looking at magic. You're looking at folklore. You're looking at stories and saying, how can I now take out interface? This should not be a screen. It should be real mind reading. So how many of us have a smart device on us right now? Like at least a phone, right? Most of us have a band. Which sort of weirdly tracks everything I do. When I swim, it knows what stroke I'm doing. That's scary. I mean, 5 years back, if somebody told me this, I would only have one word for it. That's magic. And so, I am scared as to what's next. Because as a magician, I really find it very, very difficult to imagine what's next. Because today, the threshold in people's minds is something so unimaginable that if I stand here and vanish in a puff of smoke, you would love that, wouldn't you? You would say, that's just technology. We are there. We are at a point where magic is absolutely not real. So I do not really have an answer, but I do have a belief that magicians and creators of the world will always think ahead of technology and not so much think of what technology to put in use, but to continue thinking of what technology should be created and innovated and invented. With that in mind, I thought I will take things very basic and do something that's absolutely not technological for you to end my talk. Would you like to see something?
Yes.
Okay, so, if I may, sir, would you catch this for me? Thank you. I have like 3 minutes. If you could just stand up and just lob it at anybody else in the audience, please. Just ensure there is somebody there to catch it. Awesome. Would you take that, sir? Would you take that? And would you come here, please? I normally do 3 rounds, but we rehearsed perfectly. That was a beautiful throw. Hi sir, what's your name?
Ramesh.
I have a list of books, different books. Are you into photography?
Yes,
good. Come here. So this is the top 100 books on Amazon right now. Okay? Like if you went for the first one, it would be Rick Salmon. If you went for the fifth one, it would be Irika Bokova. If you went for
let's say 29, it would be dogs. If you went for 85, it would be DSLR photography. 100 would be mountain light. I'm just gonna put them down like this. Just tell them to stop wherever you want, sir. You want that or this? This one, sure? You wanna change your mind, sir? You wanna change your mind? That's fine. Just choose any book, sir, any book at all. Any book. Which one, sir? Nests, 50 nests and the birds that built them. Now here's the thing, sir. You come on stage, I tried a random procedure to call you here. And typically the first book people go for is something that's like, you know, first or last kind of a thing. You're free to hold on to that. But if you want, you could change to something. Very sure, sir? I give you a chance to change your mind. Very, very sure? Okay. Now, I'm still asking you, do you want to change your mind? Nests and 50 nests and the birds that built them. Given a choice of top 100 books, you will choose Sharon Beale's Wonderful, 50 Nests and the Birds That Built Them. That's for you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. So indeed, thank you, sir. So indeed, he's now wondering, like, okay, can I change my mind? So yes, you do not need technology to do miracles. You can run miracles. All it really requires is a will and a desire. And for that entire bunch of people at the back, I just want you to say, have a dream, follow it, and make magic. Last slide, please. Thank you very much. Yes, I'm done. Thank you.